Good morning and welcome to the Elementary Teachers Federation of Ontario's virtual press conference on the Ford government's plan to make virtual learning permanent. Before I introduce today's speakers, I'd like to ask media interested in asking questions to please indicate so by adding a comment in the Q&A area. Please include only your first and last name and the media outlet you are with. You do not need to include your question. If you experience technical issues throughout the press conference, please use the chat to communicate with ETFO staff. Now I'd like to introduce the individuals joining us this morning. Sam Hammond, President of the Elementary Teachers Federation of Ontario. Harvey Bischoff, President of the Ontario Secondary School Teachers Federation. Dr. Carol Campbell, Associate Professor of Leadership and Educational Change with the Ontario Institute for Studies in Education at the University of Toronto. Annie Kidder, Executive Director, People for Education. Laura Kirby McIntosh, past president and current executive member of the Ontario Autism Coalition. Parker Robinson, president of the Ontario Teachers Federation. Shamila Shaquille, a York Region parent representing Ontario Families for Public Education. Romana Siddiqui, a Peel Region parent representing Ontario Parent Action Network. Liz Stewart, president of the Ontario English Catholic Teachers Association, and Vinay Roy, President of the Association des Enseignants et des Enseignants Franco-Ontariennes, and Laura Walton, President of CUPE's Ontario School Board Council of Unions. Sam, please unmute yourself and go ahead.
Thanks, Carla, and good morning, everyone. On behalf of ETFO and our 83,000 members, I'd like to thank everyone for being here with us today. We're here during Education Week, united in our strong belief that publicly funded public education must be protected from a conservative government that continues to make dangerous and irresponsible decisions that prioritize cost cutting and the economy over student safety, success, and well-being. When the Ford government announced its budget for Ontario recently, we were expecting that it would be bad for publicly funded public education, and it is. This government has cut education funding by more than $800 million next year and will implement budget freezes for the following 2 years, which will mean more cuts. But something just as concerning as budget cuts is emerging. It's something many have worried about with this conservative government. And that's their plan to privatize and dismantle publicly funded education in this province. At a time when the top education priority for the Ford government should be to ensure schools across Ontario remain open safely for in-person learning, they're planning to make virtual learning permanent while undermining Ontario's publicly funded education system. It's a plan they've been busy working on behind closed doors during a global pandemic, while families and education workers have poured their hearts into keeping students safe and learning. Their plan to make online classes permanent means a student could go from kindergarten to grade 12 without ever setting foot inside a school. And we know that students thrive in in-person environments where they learn collaboratively and where their learning is assessed daily through formal and informal observations and evaluations. And this is true for all students, but especially those in the elementary panel. Under Ford's plan, online education would be privatized and or run by TVO and TAFO, and they will be able to hire their own staff for the creation and delivery of online courses, and also outsource content creation, infrastructure, and delivery to for-profit companies. And these changes are a clear attempt to privatize online education in Ontario and to redirect funding from Ontario's public schools to for-profit providers. And this could mean no school boards, no elected trustees, no oversight, no accountability. And how will the province govern TVO and TAFO to ensure that the same high quality instruction will be present in their courses? And where do they get the money for this? Well, it will travel with students as it does with charter schools and vouchers in the United States. And this is how Doug Ford and Stephen Lecce plan to open the floodgates of privatization in Ontario by diverting precious dollars away from an already underfunded school system. And this means less funding for our schools. And anyone in smaller rural and remote communities know full well it doesn't take losing many students before schools start to close or before a school loses additional support for students and special needs. In a recent statement, the Ontario Public School Boards Association reinforced the significant negative implications for students and for publicly funded education, including impacts on reduced student funding levels and diminished local influence on education. They agree that such a move is not in the best interest of students, and they are not alone in their opinion. I'd now like to turn it over to Liz Stewart, president of the Ontario English Catholic Teachers Association. Liz?
Thank you, Sam. Ontario's Catholic teachers have a number of problems with the government's plans, not the least of which is that we dealt with this issue in the last round of contract negotiations. That would be the proper forum for these discussions. Unfortunately, we've once again seen the Ford government trying to circumvent the collective bargaining process. But our main concern is for our students. Publicly funded schools are more than just places where young people learn curriculum. Our schools also provide safety, food, resources, and social and emotional support. They're caring places where students can thrive and experience success, supported by staff who hold their safety, well-being, and achievement as priorities. This access to high-quality in-person education should not be undermined. Education and health experts are clear that in-person learning is best for academic, social, and emotional development. And Minister Lecce says he agrees, stating previously that nothing is more important than returning students to school safely because it's crucial for their development, mental health, and future success. Sick kids have stated that a daily in-person school model is best for the educational and developmental needs of children, as it allows for consistency, stability, and equity, regardless of the region in which the children and youth live. Learning is a social phenomenon. The importance of learning through play in elementary school cannot be overstated. The value of hands-on experiential learning in kindergarten through grade 12 cannot be replicated virtually. And the ability to engage in constructive in-person discussions and debates is important for students of all ages. Furthermore, in-person delivery within schools levels the playing field for all students by ensuring equity of access. We call on everyone in the education community to stand against the Ford government's plans. Students deserve our very best. Rather than taking resources out of schools, we need an historic reinvestment in Ontario's publicly funded education system. I'd now like to introduce Harvey Bishop, president of the Ontario Secondary School Teachers Federation, who'll say a few words. Harvey?
Thanks, Liz. Good morning. It's been clear for some time that the Ford government has an ideological agenda. It's not one they campaigned on or have ever admitted to, but it's been revealed through their actions and leaked memos. Now, shamefully, they're attempting to take advantage of the cover provided by a global crisis to implement it. During central bargaining, this government was intent on imposing mandatory virtual learning on all secondary students. OSSTF opposed this from the outset, because we know it is not what is best for students. I've been asked what the pros are to the government's current plan. I can't answer because I don't know what problem they are trying to solve. When Minister Lecce says repeatedly that having schools open is critical for student development, a rare point of agreement between us, but then creates a plan for permanent remote learning, it is impossible to reconcile those positions or to trust his pronouncements. We are left to wonder why a government that claims to be committed to equity would choose to push an instructional model that creates inequitable learning conditions for students. Have they considered the accessibility of these courses to English language learners and students in special education? And have they considered the impact the pandemic has had on students who identify as Black, Indigenous, and racialized? How will they be supported by this model? This plan will not support all families. It will reinforce a digital divide and be inaccessible to many. It will be a choice for some, but not all. We do not want a system where choice is exclusive to the affluent and a code for privatization. To quote the Ontario Public School Boards Association, education is an investment in the future of our children, not a revenue stream. Students deserve a fully funded education. Diverting funds to for-profit organizations would starve the publicly funded education of the resources it needs to support the whole child. As we've seen elsewhere, this approach leads to cuts to programs and fewer staff to support students and families. We urge the government to abandon this ill-conceived plan immediately. I'd like now to introduce Anne Vinay-Wah, President of the Association des Enseignants et des Enseignants Franco-Ontariens. Anne?
Thank you, Harvey. My statement will be both in French and English, so just so you know that. Pour enseigner le curriculum et apprendre le curriculum, il faut beaucoup plus que ce que nous offre un environnement d'apprentissage en ligne. Comme le décrit le document « Faire croître le succès du gouvernement », l'enseignement en personne cadre beaucoup mieux que l'école virtuelle avec la profondeur et la portée des attentes en matière d'apprentissage. Peut-être que le gouvernement connaît mal ses propres politiques et documents. Une composante clé d'une éducation financée par les fonds publics est son accessibilité à tous les élèves. En créant un modèle d'apprentissage en ligne, auquel seules certaines familles et seuls certains élèves pourront participer, compte tenu d'obstacles hors de leur contrôle, le ministre fait preuve de négligence à l'égard de son devoir d'assurer que toutes les apprenantes et tous les apprenants profitent du même succès. Ces obstacles peuvent prendre la forme d'un accès limité à un service Internet fiable ou des circonstances auxquelles font face des familles marginalisées. Quoi qu'il en soit, la réalité reste la même. Le plan du gouvernement est tout simplement inacceptable. Il est complètement inacceptable que le gouvernement Ford et son ministre Lecce aient été incapables de planifier adéquatement le retour physique ou en présentiel à l'école à plus d'une reprise au cours des derniers mois, ni d'assurer une réelle sécurité de nos communautés scolaires, mais a tout de même trouvé le temps, les ressources et l'énergie pour manigancer un plan ayant essentiellement pour but de soustraire des ressources essentielles à notre système d'éducation financé par les fonds publics de classe mondiale, dit-on, et par ricochet de négliger les réels besoins des apprenantes et des apprenants de notre province. The Ford government's intention is not about giving students and families more choice. It's about monetizing virtual learning. We will not stand by as they proceed with a plan that makes money off of families and children and takes away necessary financial as well as human resources to support students' well-being and learning. Throughout the pandemic, we have seen that virtual learning can have detrimental impacts on students' health and well-being. We have also heard from families who believe their children have thrived. However, to be clear, what students experience this school year will not be what they encounter in future learning environments run by private companies. Pour nos élèves francophones, l'école est souvent bien plus qu'un simple bâtiment ou un lieu d'apprentissage. C'est souvent un carrefour essentiel, le centre d'un grand nombre d'échanges et d'activités qui n'existent pas nécessairement à l'extérieur de l'école en français. L'école de langue française, en personne, en contexte minoritaire, contribue à la vitalité de nos communautés francophones d'un bout à l'autre de l'Ontario, en permettant aux jeunes et à leurs familles de vivre notre langue et notre culture et pas seulement l'apprendre comme matière scolaire. Selon la politique d'aménagement linguistique, la PAL, du gouvernement de l'Ontario, l'école de langue française doit compenser la position minoritaire du français dans l'environnement par un accompagnement judicieux et bienveillant. Il serait complètement illogique que le gouvernement tourne le dos à sa propre politique pour imposer une méthode d'apprentissage qui isolerait les élèves et limiterait les réels échanges entre nos jeunes francophones. As the ministry continues what it calls consultations, on its plan to make virtual learning permanent, my colleagues and I will continue to advocate against a plan that creates a two-tier system in publicly funded education. Families and students deserve an equitable, publicly funded education system that inspires learning and nurtures the well-being of all children. I'd now like to introduce our colleague, Laura Walton, President of QP's Ontario School Board Council of Unions. Laura, over to you.
Merci, Anne. On behalf of 55,000 QP education workers, I'm here to speak up for the right of Ontario students to a well-supported education, one that is publicly funded and publicly delivered. And I'm stating flatly that under no circumstances should the ministry implement this proposal. Moving students to remote learning was necessary during the pandemic, but over a year later, the downsides have become increasingly obvious. It would be disastrous to entrench them into our education system. Remote learning has had adverse effects on student literacy, and studies show they could be long-term. Remote learning means children in full-day kindergarten cannot engage fully in play-based learning with designated early childhood educators. Students with special needs do not have full personal support from education assistants. Students don't have access to school libraries or staff. Make no mistake, during the pandemic, education workers went to extraordinary lengths to support students in remote education. But the face-to-face supports of in-person learning can never be fully replicated online. And the ministry's proposal doesn't say how they'd be integrated into this model. Never forget that schools connect families and children to a community that includes custodians, secretaries, child and youth workers, speech pathologists, IT techs, psychologists, social workers, and many more. These are only some of the caring adults in schools looking out for the welfare and well-being of our students. These workers can and do help identify the student who is having difficulties at home, the young person facing abuse, the teenager in a mental health crisis, the student who is feeling isolated. Occasional check-ins cannot replace day-to-day engagement with education workers. Finally, I want to add a couple of observations related to Brother Sam Hammond's points about funding cuts and the privatization of education. Both TVO and TFO have been targeted in the past for privatization by both the Conservatives and the Liberals. And when a government turns public sector entities into revenue generators, it is often a sign that it is getting ready to sell them off to the for-profit sector. And in this instance, it would be privatizing part of the Ontario education system. We will not allow this to happen. Carla?
Thank you, Laura. I'd now like to introduce Dr. Carol Campbell, an associate professor at the University of Toronto. Dr. Campbell?
Thank you, Carla. The appropriate integration of technology is an important part of teaching and learning, and online learning has become important during the pandemic. However, the current priority is not a new permanent model centralizing and commercializing online learning. The current priority is investment in publicly funded education to support the safe reopening of schools and support for all of our students. The evidence is clear that for the majority of students, in-person schooling is preferable. Research conducted during the pandemic has indicated that with surveys of students, 43% of students, almost half, in hybrid learning and 35% of students in online learning report decreases in their learning. 84% of students surveyed in the Toronto District School Board said they learn better in person. There are particular concerns for younger children. For example, in the Toronto District School Board, there have been larger decreases in grade one reading expectations for students in online learning compared to in-person learning. When educators are asked about the experience of remote learning during the pandemic, while they're doing their very best, the majority of educators have indicated that students who have had particularly negative experiences are students living in poverty, students who have special educational needs, and English language learners. So we have learning and equity issues that need addressing. There are also mental health concerns. Students participating in hybrid learning and online learning have reported more negative emotions and that they have been worsening over the pandemic. In particular, there are challenges of a lack of social interaction. And this is important because sick kids have indicated that the major factor in deteriorating mental health is stress from social isolation. So the United Nations have warned that we could be having a generational catastrophe for students coming out of this pandemic. The priority is publicly funded education, safe reopening of schools, support for teaching and learning of the highest quality, addressing inequities, and supporting health and well-being. Thank you, Carla. I'll hand back to you.
Thank you, Dr. Campbell. I'd now like to introduce Romana Siddiqui, a Peel Region parent, who's here representing Ontario Parent Action Network. Romana?
Thank you, Carla. So during the COVID pandemic, we resorted to emergency remote learning out of necessity, shifting as needed between in-person, hybrid, and virtual learning models. Minister Lecce is leveraging and taking advantage of the situation to privatize, commodify, and commercialize Ontario's world-class education system into a revenue-generating machine. In a series of steps shrouded in the secrecy of non-disclosure agreements, the Ford government plans to defund and dismantle the public education infrastructure that took Ontarians decades to build. We are concerned about the lack of consultation and collaboration with parents and other stakeholders, which are the building blocks of transparency, accountability, and the democratic process. A fully independent online learning model delivered through TVO-TFO is currently being advanced for consideration as a full-time permanent option for all grades and mandatory two courses for secondary students in the education system by September 2021. The proposal includes an expanded mandate of TVO-TFO. While Minister Lecce redirects funding away from public education, he also expects school boards to do more with less. School boards will be required to pay a per student fee for access to the online courses, which will create a further loss of funding to school boards as students move towards the e-learning model. School boards will continue to be responsible for providing access to student supports through local schools for internet connectivity, mental health, and academic supports. But there are many unanswered questions about the new proposed legislation to the Education Act and its impact on the education system in Ontario. Under this self-directed pay-as-you-learn model, how will students develop content knowledge along with social-emotional, collaborative, critical thinking, and creativity skills, especially in the absence of relationships and interactions with other students and teachers? This past year has demonstrated how challenging it is to support student learning online. Will boards receive funding to provide space and supervision for students learning independently through TVO-TFO? We need to be critical of the use of words such as choice, access, and modernization, as these words are intentionally used to camouflage the fact that money is being redirected and taken out from the public system. Choice and modernization should not come at the expense of student engagement, success, and well-being, and the overall integrity of our public education system. Virtual learning over the past year may have been necessary and perhaps even a positive experience for some families and students, but it has not been without challenges. There has been a sharp increase in mental health concerns for children and youth, feelings of anxiety, stress, sadness, grief, and isolation among students. Many students have also experienced education deficits, learning losses, loss of focus, impaired decision-making, withdrawal, and a sense of dislocation from the world. There is also the issue of inequitable access to internet, technology, and electronic devices. Education also has a social function of developing good citizenship, inclusivity, civic engagement, and community building. Schools are the very heart of our community. We cannot overemphasize the benefits of learning in person, such as socializing with peers, collaborating on projects, participating in sports and artistic and creative activities, and connecting with people in a school community, just to name a few. Ontarians rely on public services and infrastructure funded by our government. Public education is in jeopardy, and that will leave already disadvantaged families and their children with worsening outcomes. Just as COVID-19 highlighted already existing inequities in our society, so too will defunding our public education system. We need to reject this for-profit model of education, and we need to advocate for continued investment in a fully funded and equitable public education system. Thank you, Carla.
Thank you, Romana. I'd now like to introduce Laura Kirby-McIntosh, past president and current executive member of the Ontario Autism Coalition. Laura?
Thanks, Carla. So I am the mother of two young adults with autism, and I'm a high school teacher, and as was mentioned, the past president of the OAC. I have grave concerns about the announcement yesterday that the Minister of Education is once again trying to make virtual learning a permanent part of our school system. As a mom, I've watched my youngest child suffer greatly because of online learning. The social isolation, the tech problems, and the condensed workload of this new thing that we call a quadmester have caused my child a huge amount of anxiety, including full-scale panic attacks. I worry about the academic losses, yes, but also about the loss of soft skills that students can only learn face-to-face, like teamwork, flexibility, and leadership. I worry most of all about the long-term impact on my kids' health. As past president of the Ontario Autism Coalition, I can say that online learning has been a disaster for the vast majority of our community. What I've heard from our families is that most of their kids find it next to impossible to sit in front of a screen for 4 hours a day. Most aren't getting the accommodations that they need. Those who had the support of an EA now have to rely on a parent to help them stay focused. As a result, many parents, mostly women, have had to leave the workforce to support their children's education. This government likes to talk about giving parents choice, but that choice of programming must be fully accessible. Last July, the minister received a report on how best to support students with disabilities during the pandemic from his very own K-12 Education Standards Development Committee. Anyone want to guess how many of those recommendations have been implemented? Not many. And most recently, Minister Lecce promised that students with disabilities would be able to continue with in-person learning during the current stay-at-home order. But instead, we're hearing about school boards and principals that are asking our families to keep our kids home because they don't know how to keep everyone safe. None of this is okay. Meanwhile, the teacher in me is exhausted and demoralized. Teaching online is just not natural. We teachers thrive on human relationships, and this is not that. Of course, I've learned how to make it work because that's what we as teachers always do. But if I'm honest, it's really the constant chaos in the system this year that's worn me down the most. It's the disrespect for education workers displayed by this minister. It's to the point now where I can't bring myself to watch his press conferences anymore, and I'm a news and politics junkie. He seems spectacularly unaware of the chasm that exists between his office and the realities that we're seeing on the ground in schools. He's completely out of touch. So I'm going to end by quoting my daughter, who said at a rally back before the pandemic, "Dear Stephen Lecce, no one believes you." Thanks.
Thank you, Laura. I'd now like to introduce Annie Kidder, Executive Director of People for Education. Annie?
I think that you've heard from everybody, and all of these things add up to one clear message that this move to hand over control of online learning to the Independent Learning Center, all the evidence is clear that it's not good for students, it's not good for families, it's definitely not good for public accountability, and it's not good for the public education system itself. We are in the middle of probably the biggest crisis public education has ever faced. And right now, what we need is very, very clear evidence-based, targeted resources to ensure that our students and all the people working in education and our school boards have the resources they need in order to undo some of the damage that's been done, in order to sort of set us back on the right track, to ensure that we have the mental health supports, that we have enough staff to provide all of the extra supports that students are going to need in the coming year. So for us at People for Education, this move is a huge move. It's a huge change in the public education system. Doing this in the middle of a pandemic is wrong, and it will actually harm the education of students. It is vital that we not make this big move right now, and that there is time to truly talk about this. We've been looking at a fabulous model in Scotland where they have a committee with ministers, deputy ministers, all of the leaders from education, parents, students, all working together to ensure that the education system can come back better than it was before. That's what we need in Ontario. So we need an education advisory task force. We need no changes to the Education Act right now in the middle of a crisis. And we need to take the time to look at all the implications of online learning. Some of it's working really, really well, but a move to this kind of massive change right now is simply wrong. Thank you, Carla.
Thank you, Annie. We'd now like to open the floor to media questions. Members of the media, I can ask that you please unmute yourselves prior to asking your question. I'm going to go into the Q&A section of the Zoom and just read off your name and your organization, and I'll throw it over to you. So our first question is from Daniel Leblanc from Le Droit. Daniel, your question.
Oui, bonjour. Je vais être en français. Ma question va être pour Madame Vinerois. Bonjour, vous m'entendez bien, Madame Vinerois?
Oui, je vous entends très bien, Daniel.
J'aurais deux questions pour vous, là, juste pour que les gens comprennent bien. Là. Ce qu'on dénonce un peu, c'est que le gouvernement aussi est en train de faire un peu un système à deux vitesses, là, si je comprends bien. Puis, on dit beaucoup que, dans le fond, peut-être que le gouvernement se met derrière un argumentaire que c'est les parents qu'il y a des parents qui souhaitent ça, l'enseignement à distance. Est-ce que vous, les échos que vous avez, c'est est-ce que c'est vraiment les parents qui demandent ça? Est-ce qu'il y a tant de parents qui souhaitent cette option-là ou si le gouvernement utilise cet argument-là en ce moment pour aller de l'avant avec ce plan-là?
Bien, vous avez entendu des témoignages de parents à la conférence de presse aujourd'hui et ils représentent une majorité de parents. S'il y a des parents qui souhaitent ce genre de programme pour leurs enfants, eh bien, ce genre de programme-là existe déjà d'une certaine façon dans nos conseils scolaires. Il y a déjà des modes d'apprentissage virtuel pour accommoder certains besoins particuliers ou des cours qui n'existent peut-être pas dans certaines régions, mais à ce moment-ci, on n'entend absolument pas de grand nombre de parents réclamer ce soi-disant choix-là. C'est strictement politique et c'est strictement pour faire de l'argent sur le dos du système scolaire financé par les fonds publics qui existe présentement et qui a désespérément besoin de beaucoup plus d'investissement que le gouvernement ne lui en accorde présentement.
Et deuxième question concernant le reste de l'année scolaire actuelle. Dès lundi, au Québec, toutes les écoles, à part un peu les écoles secondaires, sont réouvertes. So, on Monday, all the Quebec schools will be reopened, except some of our high schools. Est-ce que vous pensez que comment vous voyez le reste de l'année? Il reste environ 6 semaines. Est-ce qu'on espère sur le terrain? Je sais que côté nombre de cas, ça ne va pas nécessairement bien en Ontario, mais est-ce qu'on espère ne pas terminer l'année en mode virtuel? Comment on voit ça? Est-ce qu'on pense que c'est possible de les réouvrir, les écoles?
Bien, ce serait peut-être possible si le gouvernement acceptait d'investir pour vrai et de poser les gestes concrètement qu'il prétend poser, les promesses qu'il continue de faire depuis des mois, mais qui ne se transmettent pas, qui ne se traduisent pas par de réelles mesures de sécurité supplémentaires. Mais oui, dans un monde idéal, ce serait mieux si les écoles pouvaient rouvrir, pour toutes les raisons que vous avez entendues de la part de nos partenaires aujourd'hui, parce que c'est mieux d'être en personne. Le personnel scolaire préfère le en personne, c'est meilleur pour les élèves et les familles, l'économie, etc. Sauf que malheureusement, le gouvernement actuel n'investit pas le nécessaire, l'argent nécessaire ne fait pas le nécessaire pour appuyer les besoins réels actuels, continue de réclamer ou de prétendre qu'il fait X, Y, Z, qu'il investit de l'argent à gauche et à droite, mais c'est malheureusement faux, ce n'est pas la réalité.
Thank you. Our next question is from Rudy Chabin from TFO. Rudy?
Bonjour, bonjour, ma question en français, on va continuer en français, on est bien lancé. Pour Madame Anne-Vinerois, Madame Vinerois, TFO et TVO disent qu'eux, ils veulent travailler en partenariat avec les enseignants, que c'est une chance, justement, ces investissements. Et vous dites, si je comprends bien, on veut abandonner, on veut que ce soit abandonné, que le gouvernement abandonne cette voie-là. Est-ce qu'il n'y a pas une voie intermédiaire pour développer les technologies d'apprentissage en ligne comme quelque chose de complémentaire au système?
Merci, Rudy. Ce système complémentaire-là existe déjà. Donc, il y a déjà eu certains partenaires avec TVO et TFO, et ça, ce ne sont pas ces programmes-là qui étaient problématiques. Donc, oui, ce qu'il y a en place et qui peut appuyer le système scolaire actuel pour répondre à des besoins très spécifiques, on n'est pas contre ça. Le problème, c'est que l'intention du gouvernement n'est pas strictement de bâtir quelque chose de complémentaire. Il cherche absolument à bâtir quelque chose de complètement distinct avec lequel potentiellement faire de l'argent sur le dos du système actuel, du système financé par les fonds publics, qui a, encore une fois, terriblement besoin d'investissements spécifiques, clés, pour appuyer la suite des choses en éducation au niveau de l'apprentissage des élèves et toutes les problématiques qu'on a soulevées là, depuis bon nombre de mois au niveau des retards potentiels d'apprentissage et le reste. Alors, c'est l'intention malhonnête et déraisonnable du gouvernement, et c'est le cas depuis le début. Le gouvernement dit rarement la vérité.
Rudy, do you have a follow-up?
Oui, si on va dans cette voie-là, est-ce que vous craignez une disparition du CAVELFO? La deuxième partie de ma question, c'est qu'est-ce qui vous fait dire que cet apprentissage, derrière tout ça, l'apprentissage sera permanent, ce type d'apprentissage sera permanent et privatisé? Expliquez-moi ces deux formules. Est-ce que vous craignez une disparition du CAVELFO si on va dans cette voie?
À ce moment-ci, non. Le CAVELFO est là pour rester parce que c'est une entité en soi au niveau du système scolaire francophone. Mais notre crainte, c'est justement les documents et le plan qu'on a vu de la part du gouvernement sur une période de 5 ans qui montre clairement que l'intention, c'est de faire en sorte que ce programme-là demeure de façon permanente et qu'il puisse vendre les cours à l'international pour, encore une fois, faire de l'argent.
Thank you. Our next question is from Holly McKenzie Sutter from the Canadian Press. Holly?
Hi, thanks for taking the question. I wanted to ask our union speakers if you have a sense of job loss impacts that an online model would have or other workload related concerns.
Well, I can certainly start that and then I'm happy to turn it to my colleagues. Let's talk about the workload piece. And this is about, it's not just about the workload for the teachers, it's also about, and for all the education workers, it's also about the workload, quite frankly, for the students and their families that goes along with online learning. And specifically as well, when we talk about the hybrid model, which is a completely asinine creation that has been put into place across this province, where education workers are expected to try to engage and educate students not only in person, but virtually as well. So I may have 15 students sat in front of me, and I may have 10 who are connecting remotely. How in anyone's mind that works, either for the educators or for the students, I am completely flabbergasted every time I hear about it. And the workload is exponentially increased for everybody, quite frankly. For the teachers and the education workers who are trying to meet all of the needs of all of those different learners in multiple formats, and trying to meet the needs of all students is difficult enough in person, let alone when you're trying to do it in more than one venue at the same time. And then you've got the needs of the students, many of whom each and every learner has their own style, has their own supports that they require. And they're trying to vie for that. And their families, quite rightly, advocate for them, and they're trying to vie for that at the same time. So I think there's an incredible impact that comes to everybody when we talk about remote learning, either when we do it all completely remote or when we're using this ridiculous hybrid version as well. And then I'll turn it to Sam and Harvey to jump in.
Actually, Liz, right. I'd love to build on that. I agree 100% as a parent and as an education worker, what Liz is saying, the workload is astronomical. But unfortunately, you know, every document that we have seen has completely neglected the role, for instance, of designated early childhood educators that are integral to the kindergarten program. They're not mentioned whatsoever. EA support is completely neglected in the documents that we have seen. But I have heard, working with our partners, such as the Ontario Autism Coalition, the struggles that parents are having connecting their students with their EAs because there was not the sufficient funding to increase EA support. And so we have EAs who have been doing the hybrid model from the very beginning, trying to do online while providing support in schools. It just has not worked well at all for anyone. And I do think it's important to remember that nothing in education happens in isolation. You know, it doesn't just impact teachers or just impact EAs. It will be every single caring adult that we see in the school system that will be impacted. And those people play huge roles, some of which are so unwritten, in making connections with our students as they walk through those doors. And that, I think, is one of the pieces that this ministry is completely ignoring, is just the sense of community and the caring adults that are in physical schools that just will not be there remotely.
Holly, do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, I do. Thanks. I wanted to ask about, we're talking about a proposed plan that isn't public and isn't, you know, being implemented just yet, but can you be specific about any red flags or concerns that came up in yesterday's announcement about online learning for the fall?
I'll just quickly start to answer that. I think every single person who spoke here today in our press conference has highlighted all of the concerns that were brought forward yesterday around online learning, and also the fact that this government, when they announced the GSNs for 21-22, stated that, you know, they've made historical largest investment in education in the history of the universe, quite frankly, they would lead you to believe. When in fact, last year, the GSNs were 25 billion, I think 0.523, and next year they'll be 25 billion, 0.584, something like that. So it's absurd. But just to directly answer your question, think you've heard all of the concerns very clearly about any announcement around online remote learning.
Can I just add on to that for a second? From a parent perspective, I think the problem with any of Leschi's announcements is that they don't seem to stay the same for very long. I mean, Leschi said last spring that we would have classes of 15, but we all know that didn't happen. And then when teachers sounded the alarm on social media, Leschi's staff focused on damage control instead of student safety. And then, you know, Leschi promised nurses in schools, but most of them wound up doing contact tracing. Our schools opened and then they closed and then they opened and they closed again, and education workers had to beg to be prioritized for vaccinations. And Leche kept saying, schools are safe, they're perfectly safe, but everybody knows a student or an education worker who was infected with the virus. There's been over 15,000 cases in Ontario. And then, like in February, Leche said that the special COVID funding that was provided wasn't going to be renewed. But then yesterday that changed. And I mean, I suppose that's good, but why the flip-flopping? Like, who does that? It's just that's what I mean when I talked earlier about, like, it's the chaos for me that's been so demoralizing and so exhausting. And I think for whether we're talking about parents or education workers or the poor students, like, nothing seems to stay the same for more than 2 or 3 weeks at a time. It's exhausting.
Sorry, can I just jump in here, please? I just want to kind of tag on to what Laura is saying about the chaos, because what I'm seeing from parents that I'm speaking with and families is that there's a lot of chaos in terms of the lack of understanding about what this means for families when Minister Leche talks about choice. So it's great that, you know, I have no problems with choice, But we need to talk about the ramifications of the choices. So by parents and families choosing to go to online learning, that we know that that takes away funding from in-class learning, from in-school learning. And the extended effects of that obviously will be losses in terms of the number of teachers that we have. If we have fewer students in the schools, we're gonna have fewer teachers. We're gonna have fewer EAs, fewer supports generally. And it also means that our class sizes will end up being very much like they were this year. And that has an impact in terms of, again, supports for students, especially our most vulnerable students in special education programs. We're seeing it this year where the level of special ed and resource support is not the same as when we were in school. So I think that the choices are great. And I think that if they're going to provide choices, then they need to provide the funding that goes along with those choices. So that if we are going to have in-class and virtual learning, then school boards aren't switching to a hybrid model, which is not in the best interest of anybody. So what we're finding is, you know, here in York Region, we have one board that's in a hybrid model for elementary and the other board that's in a regular face-to-face model. And my understanding from the families with the hybrid model is that it's a disaster for kids, especially those in kindergarten through grade three, where teachers' attention is split between the kids in class and the kids at home. I don't even know how they do it. It's almost an impossible task. And I also have huge issues in terms of the privacy that goes along with that. So when you have kids learning at home and you have adults and siblings, quite frankly, watching and being, you know, privy to everything that's happening in the classroom, it can cause a lot of chaos in itself. There's a lot of privacy issues that go along with it. So if we had the funding to do two separate streams, where like we have this year in York Region, where we have an elementary virtual school and a secondary virtual school in addition to the face-to-face, that would be great, because then at least it's all under the umbrella of our school board and we can have a little bit of an understanding of what's happening. There's some accountability. But when we have it separate and privatized, it's just too hard to know what's going on. And the privacy issues within classrooms is a huge issue, and we should definitely all be concerned about that.
Thanks, Jamila. Our next question is from Sinead Dugal from the Queen's Park Briefing.
Hi there, good morning. Maybe just following up, Jamila kind of spoke to this, but I was hoping to hear from the union leaders. In the draft document that was circulated regarding this proposal for March, under the section on remote learning for elementary students, there was an example given there for medically fragile students, you know, saying that that was a group that potentially could benefit from this kind of a system. So I just wanted to get your take on, do you think there are any circumstances where this kind of a model could be useful, like for medically fragile students? If you could just comment on that.
I'd be willing to comment on that. Thanks for the question. I think it's important to recognize that there are circumstances for students where online learning is appropriate. But it's important to recognize that for over a decade, school boards have been providing this opportunity for those students. The school boards and the teachers who develop the courses are able to gear the courses to local perspectives and are able to interact with the student appropriately, as opposed to a centralized system where you lose that local connection for students and the special needs that might be required, accommodations are more difficult to provide in a centralized system, because the teachers or whoever's providing the courses in a centralized system would not have that connection to the particular student or access to families and the information they can provide to make make the online learning successful.
Nate, do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, thank you. I also wanted to ask about vaccines. I think there was a mention in there, but as you're aware, eligibility is opening up for all educators soon, but that also, I mean, it's unclear depending on the region when these appointments will actually be. So depending on when these educators do get vaccines, it could be that come September, some are going, are starting out school without their second dose. I'm just wondering what you're hearing from your members. Are there concerns about this? And just what you make of kind of the planning around this?
Yeah, Sine, I can help you out with that because it's been a huge concern of CUPEs all the way along. And, you know, the minister keeps bragging about, you know, there's eligibility to book, but eligibility to book is not a needle in the arm. We have had folks who have been on site every single day who still have not been vaccinated because originally they were not considered eligible to be vaccinated. We now have folks that even though they're eligible to be vaccinated are struggling because they do not have the ability to, you know, go within an hour if they get a call because they are at work. And we have, you know, school boards that need them there at work and they just can't walk away. You know, we have been asking time and time again to have mobile units out into the schools so that people can get these vaccines at their work sites. We've also said that they need to distribute the vaccines to the areas where the people are. So for instance, on the heels of the minister's announcement, Algoma Public Health Unit sent out a letter saying, sorry, that isn't the case. We don't have any vaccines here to give you. In Thunder Bay, they have been decimated by this, you know, this pandemic, and they don't have the vaccines either. So, you know, it's one thing to say eligibility. You're right. We're all watching the calendar because we know 4 months, you know, is when you're going to get the second shot. I'm concerned that there are people who not only are not going to have their second shot for September, but the fact that we have people who are currently working in our buildings who haven't received the first one at all.
So our next question is from Linda Ward from CBC. Linda.
Hi there, thanks for taking my question. We know that this fall, we are going to have some sort of online learning option. And knowing that we're sort of transitioning out of a pandemic, some nervous maybe returning to in-class learning might want to utilize this model. Do you see any value in this, at least for the immediate future?
I think it's important to note that there's no equitable expansion of digital learning without affordable internet, access to tablets and computers for all students and reliable broadband across the province. I come from an area in the province that has significant issues with reliable broadband accessibility, and there are real concerns from students, parents, and educators. Without appropriate attention and resources for these permanent online learning, or any type of learning, will disadvantage thousands of Ontario students and families. It's important that Minister Lecce and the Ford government recognize that Ontario extends beyond, you know, beyond Vaughan, and there are areas of this province that need access, and there are significant barriers to that access. When you're talking about online platforms and accessibility to the internet.
If I can add one thing also, it's that, you know, what has been proposed is a permanent shift. It is absolutely vital that there's flexibility still in the fall. But what's important now is that we're looking at what is needed, what would be most effective, what do we have to have in place for the coming year. But to make a huge permanent shift to change the Education Act in the middle of a pandemic, that is the part I think that we are all raising red flags about. There's no question that there needs to be some flexibility, but what we don't need to do right now is make this kind of huge change to the public education system itself.
If I may add to that, yes, we're talking about a permanent option, but right now what is being proposed for September is totally unacceptable. If the government had decided long ago to actually invest what it needed to be invested since last September, and we had proof in the past months that the government chose a cheap option for reopening schools, and the plan that's being proposed for this September is no different than the one we had to work with this present school year. And that is totally unacceptable. The government keeps putting band-aids all over the place instead of addressing the real problems. There are ways of making schools actually really safe, and the government is not doing that. Although it's pretending it is not. And if the schools were actually really safe, we would not need to offer that choice, that online choice to parents. Other than exceptions, that choice will not have to be there. And then it wouldn't have the negative impact it had over this school year that has already been underlined by my colleagues in regards to the hybrid model, the multitasking that is required of students and teachers and education workers, which is totally unreasonable. So there are ways out of this, and the government is choosing not to use those mechanisms.
I would just briefly like to add a comment as well. We've been through two disrupted school years, an emergency crisis response. Now, over 1.6 billion young people around the world have been through an emergency crisis response, but that's what it was. And as Annie has said, yes, there needs to be flexibility for September. We're not through the pandemic yet. However, I'm not aware of any other education system in the world that has said the entire next school year will still be an emergency crisis response. So where's the evidence around evaluation of hybrid learning, of quadmesters, of all of these things? Where's the improvement to plan forward? So yes, next year is going to continue to have some disruptions, but we need to keep planning forward with a focus on a really strong publicly funded education system, safe reopening of schools, and support for students.
Linda, did someone else want to jump in?
I just wanted to briefly add, I think an important thing that's also being overlooked is that there is very little collaboration with the different stakeholders. So it's not that there isn't a role and a place for virtual learning, but there needs to be proper consultation, and it shouldn't be shrouded in secrecy. There shouldn't be non-disclosure agreements around information that's being released from the ministry. It's not just parents. I mean, there are many stakeholders involved in the education system, and there needs to be fulsome, proper discussion, collaboration, input solicited, because that's what's really in the best interest of everybody. So when the focus seems to be kind of a cloak and dagger, smoke and mirror sorts of behavior, we don't have trust, and it contributes to that sense of chaos, and really it's not beneficial to anybody, and other than like private interests. So there are concerns because of the nature that it's been approached. Thank you.
Could I add one more thought into all of this? I think one of the most damning indictments of online learning is the number of kids who have simply exited the system and we don't know where they are. I'm really concerned about media reports that I've heard of students, 3,600 in the Ottawa region, 5,500 in Toronto, who have just, they're just gone. They're not attending school in person. They're not attending school online. The question remains, where are they and who are those kids? And I would hazard a guess that many of those children who appear to have gone missing are students with disabilities who have either themselves and or their parents have simply given up on this school year because of the level of chaos. I mean, really the truth is online learning really, as like a lot of our speakers have said this, it really only works for those who have access to technology, reliable internet, a private place to do their work, and extraordinary self-discipline, which is kind of hard to have if you're a kid in the middle of a pandemic. But I mean, the real translation there is it works really well for the privileged. But what about the rest? That's my concern.
Thank you, Laura. Follow up?
And while I have you in just a bit of a different vein, I'm just wondering what you make of the minister's refusal to definitively say whether or not students will be returning to class this school year.
I'll just very quickly say once again, he has no plan. He has no plan. He doesn't know what he's doing, quite frankly, in my opinion. And he doesn't have answers. You know, the fact that he keeps referring to, you know, we have to consult, we're looking at it, is extremely, extremely troubling.
Our next question.
Just to pick up on Sam's point about the planning or lack thereof coming from the minister, I think this is not new, right? This minister has had no plan since day one. And in fact, this government, their plan has been each and every time that we're going to have the best plan ever. And by the way, school boards are going to put that plan together, or local public health units are going to put that plan together. And that's the same with school openings, and it's the same with vaccine rollout. And that's why we're seeing this chaos within the system. And, you know, in part, I'd like to say it's, you know, just an incompetence. But my real concern is if it's not incompetence, then it's by design. And if it's by design, then it's designed to undermine publicly funded education in this province. And that is truly sad if that is the case coming from our Minister of Education.
Okay, so this will conclude the question period. ETFO President Sam Hammond will now just make a few closing remarks. Sam?
Yeah, thanks, Carla. And just very quickly, I just want to end by thanking everyone who's participated in this press conference, the media for joining us, and everyone who watched. And I just want to highlight again, what we're here for is to speak up on behalf of quality publicly funded education, our students, our members and families in this province, short-term and long-term. And to go back to what Liz said, what is actually happening here, I think you've heard time and time again, is this government is slowly but surely defunding public education, undermining public education, and slowly moving towards privatizing big sections of public education in this province. And we all together need to stand up and oppose that. Thanks to everyone for joining us.